Hello again, guys. This is the last video for Year 9 Triples. This is your chemistry lesson for Week 5, looking at allotropes of carbon. So moving on from what we've looked at so far. I hope you're all still safe and well. Managing with the work and so on that's been set. As we have been doing previously, we'll quickly have a little summary of what we've done in the last lesson. So there's 5 questions there on the screen now, if you pause and have a go at those. Okay, so last lesson we looked at metallic bonding in metallic structures. So there are 5 questions there, we'll just quickly run through those. So, 2 properties of metals. Metals are generally hard, strong, you could have also had dense, and they are good conductors of heat and electricity. Number 2, what type of ions do metal atoms form? Well, when a metal atom forms an ion, it forms a positive ion because it loses its outer shell electrons. Because it's losing negative charges, it becomes positive. Number 3, what aspect of metallic structure allows it to conduct heat and electricity? The fact that there are free or delocalized electrons that can move through the structure. So when the metal atoms form these positive ions within the metal structure, those electrons that they've lost move through the structure. Number 4, what do we call the force of attraction between a positive charge and a negative charge? That is an electrostatic force, and that is what holds metallic structures together, the attraction between the negative electrons moving through the structure and the positive ions in the structure. And number 5, what do we call the substance made when a metal is combined with another substance to give it different properties? For example, to make it harder or stronger, we call that an alloy. So when you combine another substance with a metal to give it properties for what you want to use it for, we call that an alloy. Okay. So moving on to what we're looking at today, key facts we're going to look at are on the screen, and you have them in your fact book as well, and we're going to try and cover those. This is quite a big area of science. You only need to know certain specific points about that, but there is certainly plenty of other interesting information about this you can find out, and there's a couple of links I've put at the end just to give you a little summary of it, or another way of accessing that information. Okay, so we are looking at allotropes of carbon. An allotrope, which is misspelled on the screen, it says allotrope for some reason, not typing. An allotrope is just a different form of an element. Now, carbon is just one element that has allotropes, but it's the one that you need to know about. Carbon has many allotropes. We have looked at some of those. We looked at diamond, we've looked at graphite. There are 2 of them because they are 2 different forms of carbon. There is also one called graphene that we'll look at in a moment, and there are others called fullerenes, which we'll look at in a moment as well. And all of these have key properties which make them very useful to us and very useful potentially in the field of science and technology, that we, for reasons that we're going to look at fairly briefly in this video. So, fullerenes are one type of carbon allotrope. We looked at diamond and graphite. We don't need to discuss those again. So, the first fullerene that was discovered, the fullerene is just a hollow form of carbon, of a carbon allotrope. The first of these that was discovered by accident in 1985, and it was called Buckminster fullerene. Okay, and it was basically has a structure of a spherical structure or a ball structure, and it's sometimes called buckyballs. Okay, but its discovery opened up a whole new area of chemistry looking at these types of structures that we find carbon in. Okay, now that is a picture of a Buckminster fullerene molecule, and you can see that in each case you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 sides. It's made up of hexagons of carbon atoms joined together to make a ball or a sphere, and that's quite a usual shape for a fullerene, but they can have other shapes as well. Okay, now the chemical properties of Buckminster fullerene, which has the formula C60. So in one of those spheres, there are 60 carbon atoms. Made it very useful and very interesting to scientists. Okay, because the molecules were hollow, they can be used to trap atoms and other smaller molecules inside them. Their surfaces can be coated with other atoms, which can make them very useful, as we'll look at briefly in a moment. They can also be joined together with each other or other molecules to make larger fullerene hollow structures for other uses as well. So as I said, fullerenes are just forms of carbon with hollow shapes. They're generally based around hexagonal rings of carbon atoms, which is the most usual, but they can be pentagonal, and they can also, which is five carbon atoms, obviously, as in a pentagon in maths, or heptagonal rings, which have seven carbon atoms. As we said, Buckminster fullerene was the first to be discovered, and they can be commonly used as catalysts, as we'll look at in a second, and lubricants. They can also be quite useful in medicine because they can potentially be used to deliver drugs into the human body because you can trap drug molecules inside them, and that allows them to transport them into the body without the drugs being released until such a point that we want that to happen. Okay, so some of the uses: they can be used to make non-stick slippery coatings on machinery because you can use these tiny little molecules as miniature ball bearings effectively to allow surfaces to slip over each other more easily. So it can be used as a lubricant. They can be used, as I've said, to deliver drug molecules directly into the human body, into the actual sites in the body where they need to be used. They can be used as molecular sieves, so they can trap certain particles and let others pass through. They can be used to soak up toxic substances in the body. They can also be used as catalysts for certain chemical reactions. Now, graphene is another allotrope of carbon. Graphene is basically, we looked at graphite in a lesson or two ago. Graphite forms in layers, if you remember. Layers of carbon atoms all bonded to three other carbon atoms. And then it had weak forces between the layers, which made it a fairly soft substance. That's why we use it in pencil lead. Now, graphene is a single layer of graphite. Now, it doesn't sound very technical, but you can separate a single layer of graphite from the other layers using sellotape, and that single layer is referred to as graphene. Now, graphene is potentially a very useful substance because it will still conduct electricity, because those carbon atoms in that layer still have delocalized electrons. Because it's only one atom thick, that makes it very, very light. It is practically a two-dimensional structure. However, it is also very, very strong, because you still have the strong covalent bonds between the carbon atoms within the layer. Okay, so it has many potential uses in electronics and in materials, because obviously it conducts electricity, but it also is a very strong substance, so it can be used to enhance the strength of materials without making them heavier, because it is such a light substance, but also still very strong. Now, what we've been looking at is what we call nanoscience. Okay, nanoscience is dealing with particles that are very, very small, very, very tiny particles, and it's a huge area of science, as I've said. We're only covering it very, very briefly. Okay, now, because nanoparticles are so small, that gives them a huge surface area compared to their volume or mass. The smaller a particle is, the greater its surface area. Now, that means we can use far fewer of them for certain things, for example, as catalysts, rather than using normal-sized particles, which makes them cheaper and more efficient, which is very important in science. Okay, so we've already looked at very many potential uses for nanoparticles, catalysts being one of them. Because they have a high surface area, that means there's a large surface area for reactions to take place, which therefore speeds up the reaction more effectively. We've looked at the idea of using fullerene nanoparticles to deliver drugs into a specific area of the body, and with the idea of using carbon nanotubes or graphene nanotubes in computer chips and in electronics because they conduct electricity. Even in deodorants, we could use nanoparticles and fullerenes because some of them have antimicrobial properties, which means they could make deodorants more effectively by killing the bacteria that make sweat and things like that smell bad. So lots of potential uses for this area that we've been talking about. Now, nanotubes are basically hollow tubes made up of nanoparticles. So they are another form of fullerene. They are tubes made up of hexagons of carbon. So all of these little hexagon shapes has a carbon atom at each point, and they can be rolled up into cylinders, or they can be rolled up into cylinders. So basically sheets of graphene rolled into cylinders. Now again, they have many properties that make them useful to us. They have a very high tensile strength, so you can exert large forces on them and they won't snap or stretch or bend. They conduct electricity, they conduct heat very well. Again, both of these properties are due to the free electrons in their structure. And you can also create multi-walled nanotubes, so basically tubes within nanotubes inside each other, which can rotate and slide inside each other practically without any friction at all. We can attach atoms to the outside of the tubes, which gives them many potential uses. So the potential uses for them would be for things like television and other audiovisual screens, optical fibers to carry information, waterproof fabrics, building materials, electrical circuits, all of these things. Okay, so all of these could be enhanced by using nanotubes, because of the properties they have, the high tensile strength, the electrical conductivity, and the fact that they are so light because they're made of such thin sheets of carbon atoms. Okay, now as I said, there is some more that is really quite a broad area. So there is a nice summary on the bite-sized section of the BBC website. There is also a little video link I've given you there, which covers the key points you need to take away from it quite well. Okay, so looking back at the fact book, we know that there are allotropes of carbon. They are being created and made all the time because of the potential uses they have. Fullerenes are carbon molecules that are shaped like closed tubes or hollow balls. They're made of carbon atoms arranged generally in hexagons, but sometimes pentagons and heptagons. Fullerenes can act as cages to trap other different molecules inside them, so that would allow them potentially to be used as drug delivery systems. They also have a massive surface area, so they can make brilliant catalysts. Okay, as I said, it's a really, really big area, so don't let it, don't get too bogged down with it. Try and take away these key facts, but if you have a look at the GCSE link I've given you and the little video, it also summarises it quite well. Okay, hope that has been of use to you and has helped your understanding. Thank you.